In this video, we're going to introduce two new things. So one is a technique, a very awesome general technique called data augmentation. And we're also going to introduce a new data set called CIFAR, which is kind of like the next data set that everyone uses after MNIST. It's slightly bigger images, and it's color images, and it's images of kind of everyday objects. But these images are still small, and it's still a relatively easy classification task. In fact, these days, the best classifiers get up to 99% accuracy, which is really amazing. It's definitely better accuracy than I could get personally. Data augmentation generally is the practice of taking your data and modifying it. So this has a lot of different advantages. One advantage is that it helps the model generalize the data better, right? So in cases where you don't have enough training data, you can sort of get more training data by taking the things you have and changing it a little bit, right? So, you know, one of the things you do might be like rotate your images, like maybe like 5 degrees randomly. And you know that like a frog rotated 5 degrees is still a frog, or a frog, you know, flipped across like a horizontal axis. I mean, a vertical axis is probably still a frog, right? So we do all these transformations before we send the data through to get classified. We probably wouldn't do this on our testing data, but on the training data, it's totally fair game. And the particular transformations you do are really based upon your knowledge of your data set. Like, how much can you really distort an image before it becomes potentially something different? It's something to think about and apply domain knowledge to. Also, different types of images might have different appropriate transformations, right? So, you know, a face turned upside down might be really different. It might be really, you know, maybe not a kind of face you want to classify, but a satellite image rotated 180 degrees is probably still a satellite image of the same thing that you might really see. So aerial photography, you can do kind of more rotations and more vertical flipping, whereas images from an upright camera, you probably wouldn't want to do too much rotation around the vertical axis, because in the real 3D world, the vertical axis is something that we care about. So as usual, we start off with a whole bunch of imports, especially the Keras library that we use extensively here. And if you have any questions about what I'm doing up until the data generation, I really recommend going back and reviewing previous videos on convolutional neural networks, and maybe even the video on perceptrons and multilayer perceptrons. So first we import Keras and some other useful tools. So then we set some configuration parameters and we download the CIFAR library. There's actually two versions of CIFAR. There's CIFAR 10, which has 10 classes, and CIFAR 100, which is a little harder because it has 100 classes. In this case, I've actually spelled out the class names for you. It's airplane, automobile, bird, cat, deer, dog, frog, horse, ship, and truck. Very similar to MNIST, we set those variables in xtrain, ytrain, xtest, and ytest. So, you know, xtrain is the actual pixels of each image that we're dealing with in our training set, and ytrain is the labels, and so on. As usual, I think it's smart to take a look at a few of the images and get a feel for the data that we're working with before we start to try to classify it. So here I've plotted xtrain 1, which is probably the second image in our xtrain set. And you can see that it's probably a truck, but even it's kind of hard to tell. It's at such low resolution that this task is fairly hard even for a human. We can look at, say, xtrain 10 and see that I think that's a deer, but it's quite dim. Some of these images actually are tricky. Next, we one-hot encode our output labels. And we normalize our images. So instead of, they come by default with their RGB values between 0 and 255. And we want to change that to be between 0 and 1. So we do that. And then we set up a kind of standard small convolutional network in Keras. So it's a sequential model. And we use a 2D convolution with a 3x3 convolution. And we use the padding to kind of keep the size the same. So we pad out a little bit to make sure the convolution doesn't change the dimension. And then we use the ReLU activation function. We do the standard max pooling, flatten things out, and then have two dense layers. And we've inserted two dropout layers to help with overfitting. And this is exactly networks that we looked at in the earlier convolution section on that we did on MNIST. The only difference here actually is that our input data is three-dimensional instead of two-dimensional, because our input images are actually colored images. So color here is the third dimension, whereas with MNIST, they're black and white images, so it's a two-dimensional input data. Next, we compile the model with the usual categorical cross-entropy, because we're doing a multi-class classification and the atom optimizer. And then before we start getting crazy with the data augmentation, let's just fit this model on the basic data. And we can run this, and you'll see that it gets reasonably good accuracy. You can see that it gets reasonably good accuracy. The validation accuracy here is actually higher generally than the accuracy because we have dropout. But it looks like the validation accuracy tops out at around 63%, which is reasonably respectable. But we only have 50,000 training examples, so it does seem like this could benefit potentially from augmenting the data. So let's do that. And Keras actually makes it quite easy to do data augmentation. And we do this by setting up an image data generator. Now, there's two reasons to use data generators in general. So what this does is instead of setting a variable with all the data, it has a function that will return batches of training data examples. So one reason to use it, and the reason we're using it here, is because it lets us do modifications to the data as we pass it through. So this data generator is actually going to take the images and it's going to stretch them and squeeze them and rotate them. And that all these things it can do because it's doing a generator. Each time it'll be a little bit different. The other thing that a generator can do is actually just prevent you from having to put all your images in memory. And I'll tell you, when you work on real world data sets, that becomes a big issue. So in most production systems, you'll probably be using a data generator versus just passing in gigantic variables into your fit function. So generator is good to learn anyway, but great for this example. And here I've set width shift range to 0.1, which means that it's going to shift the width of the image by up to 10%. So it's going to expand and squeeze the image by up to 10%. But it's cool to actually look at the Keras documentation and see if there's any other things that we might want to try. Like, for example, we might want to do a little bit of rotation on the image. Or another thing that we could do is horizontal flip. Does that mean that half the time we actually classify the mirror image on the image of the image? So why don't we also add that? And now we call dataGen.fit on xTrain. And actually what this does is it attaches the data generator to the xTrain variable. So at each step, it's going to pull a batch size worth of images from xTrain, but it's going to modify those images with the functions that we added. So, you know, once we've set up the data gen, then we call fit generator. This is a lot like model.fit, but instead of passing in complete arrays, you actually pass in a function that returns these arrays in batches, right? So our data gen here is passing through xTrain and yTrain in chunks of size, batch size. So we actually need to set batch size equals config.batch size in here. And then I like to set the steps per epoch, because otherwise you won't actually really have epochs, right? Because you know, an epoch is typically when you've stepped through all the data, but when you have a generator, you're essentially generating infinite amounts of data, right? So there aren't really epochs, but it's nice to have sort of natural breakpoints where you check the validation data. And so I set steps per epoch typically equal to be the size of the data, and that's xtrain.shape 0, divided by config.batch size. So this means that we're basically going to have the same number of steps for epoch as we would have had if we had just called model.fit. And so we can set epochs and validation data and callbacks in exactly the same way that we would have otherwise. And so it's interesting to think before this runs what this is going to do to accuracy and validation accuracy. Typically, what we'll see is it'll make the accuracy lower because we've actually made the classification task harder, right? We've sort of added some random noise into that task. But hopefully, in order to complete that task, it's going to actually make the model generalize better. And maybe, if we're lucky, it'll make the validation accuracy higher than it would have otherwise. If you compare the validation accuracy of our CNN with augmentation, it's actually better than our vanilla CNN, and it's steadily improving over time. So we can add all kinds of things, and this is a rich vein of things to try to make your model better, but we can go back in and add all kinds of transformations to keep improving the generalization of our model in this data set. So, you know, just backing up, in general, this kind of augmentation is different in every domain. In text, one thing people do is they'll actually translate their text into a different language using Google Translate and then translate it back into the original language, which kind of adds like a little bit of noise, but often keeps same semantics. And in audio, people add, you know, kind of background sound effects or distort the audio just a little bit to, you know, kind of get variations on the audio. So this is a really general technique. It works really effectively. And I hope you enjoyed this video.